Transcript for the announcements will be on the email, just FYI.
Celebration. Good morning, everyone. Good morning. Good to see everyone. So, welcome, Unity Church of the Hills. I'm Reverend Cherie Taylor Jones. I'm still the minister here, so I think that's a good news. I'm just coming up on month four. It's been 4 months already. Can you imagine that? Thank you. That has gone so quickly. And if you are joining us online, we'd like to say thank you. Thank you for joining us. I'm realizing Graham waved the mask at me in the back. Take off your mask, honey. So we are glad that you chose to spend this time with us in sacred service as we look at what is ours to do. And if you're new for the first time, you can type connect in the comments section and someone, one of our ambassadors, will get in contact with you to give you more information. And if you're new here, there's a connect card that you can fill out, and when the basket comes along, just throw it in there and someone will reach out to you again. We like reaching out to folks here, don't we? What's wonderful about this community is whoever you are, no matter what race, color, what your belief is, what your identity is, what your sexuality is, all is welcome here. And that's what I love about New Thought and just being in that awareness. So we are back in the sanctuary. There's no RSVP needed, so just come, wear your mask, and just be in on this sacred ground. Because it really has this beautiful energy when you get to walk the campus and sit in the sanctuary or the chapel. It's just imbued with spirit every moment that you're here. So take advantage of that and come. We're open. We're here for you. The kids, we are still keeping them virtual at this time because of the Delta virus and how rampant it is and how it's impacting kids. So right now they are still virtual. We'll keep that going for a couple more weeks. And when we get more data, then we'll make a different decision on that point there. If you would join me on our prosperity vision. So I've talked about how our team, Tammy, started the lead there with it, and how we envision what we see prosperous-wise, prosperity-wise for this community. So if you're willing, let's say this together. With God, all things are possible. And by the end of 2021, Unity Church of the Hills will have 500 attendees every Sunday and averaging gifts and tithes of $25,000 per week, and in additional unexpected income of $100,000, this and better. This stuff works, my friends, and let me tell you why I'm telling you that it works. Got a check yesterday for $20,000. $20,000. The tears started. Do you know what I'm saying? The tears started. It was just this wonderful thing of knowing someone just paid for a week. Like, that's our minimum for 1 week. We can do amazing things here. We cannot outgive God, people. It's time. Let's start doing this work that is ours to do. All right. I know I'm like, wah! All right. Thank you for your patience with me. You see that beautiful picture of Adrian Lorenzo Maxi Solomone. He is a child of one of our members, Kathy Maxi Solomone. He died, 22 years old. We had his memorial service yesterday, and so we just wanted to inform the community that he has passed in a car crash. So it was a beautiful ceremony, but it was also hard yesterday. You know, it was just this light that just was beloved to so many and was the light for so many. So just to let you know what's going on in our community, I've promised to be transparent with you and let you know as things are going on. All right, the other thing that's coming up on a happier note is Paul Selig is coming here to Unity Church of the Hills. That is really exciting. Super exciting. He is working on his 10th book, my friends. His 10th book. He's a channeler. If you are impassioned about A Course in Miracles, this is quite similar work. And it's just like, you know, every time there's a revelation, it just, there's an extra oomph, an extra depth that we as a culture are able to hear and able to work with. So I'm so excited that he's coming. And there's a little clip that I'd like you to watch.
I'm a conscious channel. I take dictation from the guides that I work with.
Let's go.
I sit in a chair, I close my eyes. I imagine that I'm climbing into the back seat of a car and turning the steering wheel over to the guides that I work with. I'll hear one phrase repeated incessantly, and once I give voice to the one phrase, everything else that my guides have to say comes tumbling out afterwards.
I know for certain that there is more than we've been taught, and I know for certain that everyone in this room is far more extraordinary than they've ever been told.
Every workshop is different, but what the guides will generally do is introduce their teaching, what they plan on taking their students through, and they'll attune everybody to the energy that they work with. Once you're attuned, you become the radio that can hold the higher broadcast. The guides say that broadcast has always been there, but we haven't known how to play it, or we haven't been given permission to do so by a world that says such things just can't be so.
So let's start with our Q&A. Who has there we go. I've been giving a lot of water. I would like confirmation from the guides.
So what are you getting with water?
A lot of big waves.
Big waves, present now. But they're saying it's present now. You're all getting waves. You're all getting waves. You're all having to integrate them, and that's very comfortable. And Nanda, it's very comfortable if you haven't noticed. If you haven't noticed.
What's happening collectively?
It feels like we will never be totally fulfilled.
When I tune into you, it's really interesting. It's almost like feeling combustible when I go to you. I could combust.
Would it be alright to ask you how have I grown wonderfully and what is the next learning lesson?
It's a deep desire for acceptance. I'm allowed to be as I am. Nobody has to tell me I'm wrong. See, the mind-blowing thing for you is, because when I get the jaw drop, that's the big truth. I just get to be.
So Paul Selig is internationally known. And what this has the potential to also do is draw from the community into here, that they can experience Unity Church of the Hills for the first time as well. So it's a win-win. The last piece is, the end of this month, in a few days, is the end of the early bird. And the early bird registration, you get to save $100, so it's normally $395. So it'll be $295 if you register before the end of August. And there's a 15% discount if you use the word UCOH, and you'll get a 15% discount. So I just have to tell you that I'm a huge fan, if you haven't figured that out yet, I'm a huge fan of Paul Selig, and I have to tell you, since I've been doing his work, I was introduced to him seminary, so probably 2013, 14, somewhere in there, and it shifted and transformed me. Like, it accelerated my level of transformation. So if I can just encourage you to participate in this, I really do, because it just made a profound difference in my life. All right, we've got our own Frank Phelan coming up to do our opening prayer. And so if you're ready, just take that nice deep breath. Exhale.
Good morning. Good morning. So this week I had a business trip up to Kansas City and had the opportunity to visit Unity Village for the first time, and was fortunate enough that Tammy and Joni were there and Kim was there, and we got to spend some time together on the campus. And as we were touring around, we walked into a little chapel that I later found out was called the Peace Chapel. Very small room, 12 feet wide by about 18 feet long, a row of chairs on each wall. In the front, there was a stand with the Bible on it. And on the wall behind it were the words painted, "Peace, be still." And so we soaked up the space for a minute, and then organically, we all just sat down in silence for a while. And it was magnificent. We were just following the instructions that were on the wall. You know, there are always storms or things that look like storms going on. And the way we come into those is so important. It's how we be before we do what we are to do. And today, we can hold the consciousness of that peace for Adrian's family, for the people in Afghanistan that are undergoing what they're undergoing, and for the people that are going to be impacted by the hurricane, which probably will be very many people. And so holding that space of peace and love and moving from that centered condition into whatever it is that's ours to do, whether it's to volunteer, contribute towards efforts that are helping out those folks, bringing it from that centered space. So today's prayer, I'd like to work from that place of peace, be still, through our principles. So if you're comfortable, if you could please close your eyes and settle into your chair and take a breath. Peace, be still. And know that there is one power and one presence active in the universe and in our lives, a loving God. Peace, be still, and know that we are of that essence. We are the inheritors of that unconditional love. Peace, be still, and know that we co-create through our thoughts the ideas held in mind. Peace, be still, And know that by this activity of prayer and meditation, we get to align our thoughts with divine spirit. Peace, be still, and know that through the activity of our thoughts, our words, and our actions, we get to manifest and demonstrate that unconditional love in all of our activities. Peace, be still. Peace, be still. Peace, be still. And so it is, and so we let it be. Amen.
This is also a special Sunday. This is what we call our new member Sunday. And it's for folks who have gone through the 5 weeks of training. Thank you, my love. 5 weeks, I'm so conditioned now. 5 weeks of training with Tammy and with Bob Withrow, and I got to participate this time as well. So it's just like wonderful to welcome and embrace and share our knowledge about unity principles with them. So if you've just completed the PATH class, please come on up. If you completed it a little while ago and it was virtual and you couldn't come up, we invite you up as well, please. Please come on up and be welcomed into your new spiritual family home.
It was such a joy to spend 5 weeks with them and just to see the bright lights that they are, the wisdom that they bring, and their love for you and for this community. And so this is our opportunity to share our love with them and to also recommit ourselves. Every time I go through the PATH class, it's a reminder for me to recommit my love and my time and my talents and my treasures to this amazing community, to all of you. And so let's just take a moment together, just a moment of silence as we drop into our heart spaces. Earlier, Frank Phelan spoke about why this community is as large as it is. And the answer is unconditional love. And so it's our joy to share this unconditional love with all of you. We have a blessing that we want to all speak together, so we would invite the congregation to join with me as we love on you guys. Dear ones, we welcome you and bless you just as you are, a perfect, whole, and complete expression of God. We welcome you and bless you as new members into this spiritual community, an ever-expanding community of love and acceptance where lives are indeed transformed. We hold sacred space for your spiritual path to be illumined as it unfolds and expands. We give thanks for your gifts already present and for those gifts yet to be revealed. We are grateful that you have chosen to become a vital part of this community. We look forward to your love and support of our spiritual home, for it is now yours as well. We love you. Welcome home! Woo! Thank you, guys. Thank you so much. Thank you.
It's a new season. It's a new day. A fresh anointing is flowing up my way. It's a season of power and prosperity. It's a new season, and it's coming to me. It's a new season, it's a new day. A fresh anointing is flowing my way. It's a season of power and prosperity. It's a new season coming to me. It's a new season. It's a new day. A fresh anointing is flowing my way. It's a season of power and prosperity. It's a new season. It's a new season. It's a new season. All painful thoughts are gone, no longer can they bother me. 'Cause the creator of the universe, God comforts me. And it's transferable, your children's children will be free. It's a new season.
It's a new season.
Debts are canceled and your children walk in victory. It's all available to you right now. Wait and see. It's a new season.
It's a new season. It's a new day. A fresh anointing is flowing my way. It's a season of power and prosperity. It's a new season. It's a new season. It's a new season.
If you believe, say yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. Yes.
Yeah. 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 Yeah.
The new millennium presents a new horizon, and no greater time for us to make a choice and take a stand. All that we need is rally safety and the teacher's hand. It's a new season.
It's a new season. All that was stolen is returned to you a hundredfold. Tried in the fire, but you're coming out gold. Cling to God's hand, say yes to every promise, take a hold. It's a new season.
It's a new season.
It's a new season. It's a new day.
It's a new day.
A fresh anointing.
It's
flowing my way.
It's flowing my way.
It's a season of power.
It's a season of power.
And prosperity.
And prosperity.
Hey, yeah.
It's a new season coming to me. It's a new season coming to me. It's a new season coming to me.
Matt and Brian, thank you so much for jamming with us. We just love you, so thank you. We've got an amazing team. We've got such talent in this place. And so today what we are going to do, we are going to talk in depth about Unity's fifth principle. You know, the one that says, through our thoughts, our actions, our words, what? We live the truth. We live the truth, we know. And I don't know about you, but I'm getting this sense that here in our society, on this planet Earth, we are at a particular time where we're just on the precipice of great change. Do you feel that? Yeah. And when we are feeling that, it can feel overwhelming at times to figure out what is mine to do in this. So we're going to talk about that. How do you answer the call to live the truth? Right before I started writing this talk, I was on this app that's called Nextdoor. You know, Nextdoor app. I love that app. It's a great app. It talks about connecting community, connecting the neighborhood together. So I love that. I go out there periodically, especially since I'm new to the Austin area, to find out what's happening. And one of my neighbors was complaining about the trash that the homeless population are creating right at Lakeline Mall and 183. And as I was reading all of the responses, it was really interesting to hear what other people should do about the issue, right? And what was really heartbreaking for me was that most of them missed the fact that these were human beings not living their best lives, that they were battered people who were struggling with life. Unity Church of the Hills here, we see ourselves as spiritual practitioners, right? We don't talk about spirituality as theory. We talk about it impacting and changing our lives. And we say that all are welcomed here, and transformation is possible. And yet, I wonder what our responses would be to the garbage that has been created by the homeless. I wonder what our responses are when a homeless person simply hangs out at the grounds here and maybe takes a break from the heat by coming inside. I wonder what our responses are to the people in Afghan who are being beaten, tortured, and killed. You see, these are all tough situations, but they are here to ask us to respond from our highest self. Being the spiritual light in the world does not mean passivity, my friends. When we see abuse, neglect, or poverty, guess what? There's something for us to say and do. Being a frequency of love in the world means it is necessary for us to speak a strong no if we see something that is no longer acceptable. We are being called from spirit to say no to any treatment that is less than human. Less than human. No one deserves to be treated less than human. Thank you. Thank you. So what happens once we say no to anything less than love? Once we awaken to the injustices in life? Well, the answer is short. We are called by spirit to act. That's it. We are called by spirit to act. Often in New Thought spiritual communities, you know, we kind of get stuck when action is needed. I think it's because we haven't had a lot of practice in how to act from our power-filled divine nature. I'm not saying we aren't loving people. Of course we are. And we've spent a lot of time recognizing there is only one presence and one power in the universe. God. God the good. God the magnificent. We understand that we co-create through our thoughts held in mind. And we practiced harnessing our thoughts and reframing our perceptions of the world around us. We've practiced using affirmative prayer to harness our power to co-create. We've practiced meditation to center in truth and love, which enables us to walk in the world as a loving presence. But you know what we haven't had a lot of practice doing? Taking those big, bold actions. in communities, in our cities, in our neighborhoods, to create the world we wish to live. Of course, it's important to hold the high watch. Yes, it is, and it's necessary to move in love in action. Now, I know some of you are thinking, but Rev Sheree, we do stuff here. I know you do. And that's really cool, and that's what's attracted me to this community. You've done some wonderful things in the past to support those in need. Did you see my paper flying? What? Right? You've done the Habitat for Humanity, hands-on housing, you've done interfaith work, you've supported those in the aftermath of Hurricane Katrina. And those are powerful actions. And a lot of them were a long time ago, my friends. What? Yes, they were a long time ago. Some people say 5 years, some people says, you know, over 10 years. And you know what? That's like me saying, in 2010, you know, I brushed my teeth twice a day for a year, and it's good enough. It's like us saying, we marched in the 60s, and it's no longer necessary for us to act on inequality or hatred. So the question is, how much do you want to change the world? A little or in a huge way? Because if you want to change the world in a huge way, it means staying engaged with what's going on in the world and taking steps, actions to make it better. When I was writing this talk, a biblical verse came to mind. You know, and it was that one that says, faith without works is dead. Faith without works is dead. We could say affirmative prayer without works is dead. We could say meditation without works is dead. This quote comes from the book of James, chapter 2, verses 14 to 17. And it says this. What good is it, my brothers and sisters, if you say you have faith but do not have works? Can faith save you? If a brother or sister is naked and lacks daily food, and one of you says to them, go in peace, keep warm, and eat your fill, and yet you do not supply their bodily needs, what is the good of that? What is the good of that? So faith by itself, if it has no works, is dead. So faith by itself, if it has no works, is dead. So I'm going to give you a little backstory. The book of James is written to the Jews in dispersion. So what does that mean? It means that these were the Jewish converts to Christianity that were scattered throughout the Roman Empire. And the identity of the author has been kind of challenged by different theologians, but it seems when you do enough reading that it's James the Just, the brother of Jesus who wrote this book. And he was the leader of the Jerusalem Council. And what that means is he stayed in Jerusalem and led the Jews that were converted to Christianity. Paul, the Apostle Paul, he went all around the world, right? He spoke to the Gentiles, the pagans, to convert them to Christianity. And because of the tone of this book, this is before Paul had some issues with those Gentile converts, because the tone of this chapter, this book, is very Hebraic, meaning that James was writing to a people that understood the Hebrew laws. And what he was saying to them is, dudes, you gotta live the law. Live the law. This is a call for the practical application of Jesus's evolution of consciousness. You see, we quote Jesus. We talk about Jesus as our way shower. But you know, Jesus didn't just sit and talk and explain truths. Jesus healed the blind, healed the lame, resurrected the dead, fed the hungry, changed consciousness, and so much more. James is reminding these converts that saying something like, I behold your divinity. What? I behold your divinity is meaningless without taking actions to support those in need. James is asking, how would empty words help those who are impoverished? How would empty words help you to grow in consciousness? Let's face it, if your words are simply to make yourself feel better or give the illusion of sympathy, then they are empty. Let's look at another example. If we see the degradation, torture, killing, and systemic devaluation of people of color's lives, and we say, that's so horrible. That should not be happening in 2021. And then perhaps offer up an affirmative prayer. That, my friends, is the epitome of prayer without works is dead. Did you hear me? It is fake faith and mock charity. It is the outpicturing of an unawakened consciousness and our inability to be compassionate. Saying we are an evolved consciousness and taking no action is simply lip service to an imaginary status. Did you get that? I'm preaching today. Gloves off, baby. We're preaching today. Our works must manifest as the practical application of spiritual evolution. That's what we're being called to do. Walking in the world as an awakened consciousness means, yes, we pray and meditate. We also look at our unconscious biases that allow us to support broken systems in place, which can only thrive our ignoring those who are in need. So let me say that again. We look at our unconscious biases because they are supporting systems that can only thrive by the detriment of others. Others in need, need of homes, need of income, need of equality, need of security. And once we challenged those inaccurate beliefs of separation, we then must take action to eradicate the systems which abuse those less fortunate. How can we do anything else? It's a threefold process. Total engagement of our mind, our soul, and our body are required. From the mind, connecting with our highest self through prayer and meditation, to receive those downloads which give us the thoughts to co-create. From our soul's perspective, to discern truth. We are divine human beings. All of us are of God. All of us are equal. And then allowing that truth to permeate our being as we challenge any false beliefs. And our body to take those actions from those downloads, from those truths, to manifest into creating a new world that works for all. Now, I know this may sound irreverent for some of you, but somehow in our magical thinking, we've come to believe that the evolution of consciousness means we must be happy at all times. We must be comfortable. We must not rock the boat. We must not say no. We must not speak up when things are being treated badly. That's not what evolution of consciousness is. Evolution of consciousness means we allow all of the emotions that we experience on this planet, first of all, to be acceptable. All emotions are necessary. Just as the rain and sun are necessary, one is not better than the other. We need both. We need all of it. It also reminds us that all the experiences that we have in our life is for our highest good. But here's the other piece of that. Evolution of consciousness means we aid our brothers and sisters, knowing that they are of God. Therefore, they are of me, they are of you. Evolution of consciousness means I can change beliefs that no longer serve me and are not of truth. Evolution of consciousness means I know there is enough for all and I can never outgive God. Evolution of consciousness means I am my brother's and sister's keeper. Evolution of consciousness means I may be afraid, but I have enough faith to take action on behalf of another. So when we ask ourselves the question, what is ours to do? You know, I've got some suggestions for you. My first is always to start with love. Let love be your guiding compass. And then first, love yourself. As you look at your unconscious biases, do so without judgment. Because here's the thing, my friends. If we were raised in Western culture, we have biases. Each and every one of us does. I have biases. I work at them. But we all have biases. And ours is to discern what they are, release them, and create new ones. If we're co-creators, we can create new beliefs. It's possible. Second, love others. So as you observe actions that people are taking imperfectly, to make a difference in the world, observe them without judgment. Observe them without judgment. Because you know what? Their actions are going to run the gamut, anger to apathy. And know that they are doing the best that they can in that moment. So when you see the homeless underneath the underpasses of 183 or any other highway, instead of sitting in judgment of them, how about they're doing the best that they can? How about thinking, what could have happened in my life that would have made me believe that that is my only option? You see, it's in our belief in separation that we create this us versus them mentality. And we forget to love our brothers and sisters as ourselves. The roots of biases in this country, they are long and they are multi-generational. And you know what? That means it's going to take a long time to work that through. But we can work that through. The next is to focus then on what your next step is. So looking at what's right in front of you now, because what do we know? We only have this now moment and act from there. So what can you do? Here's some tips. You can read a book about institutionalized systems. You can write letters to the editor, letters to people in prison, letters to workers who are making a difference in the world. You can strike up a conversation with someone outside of your comfort zone. You can watch the movie Just Mercy, which is a powerful movie about the injustice of the prison system. You can join a social media group that is taking actions. You could look for what people are doing and be inspired by them and join them. You can house, feed, clothe, visit those less fortunate. You see, it's across the gamut. You don't have to do something huge. How about visiting someone who's lonely? Someone who doesn't have food, bring them a meal. All of that, my friends, is taking action. You can also take a class to discern what your spiritual gifts are so that you can get more clarity on what's yours to do and give. And guess what? We're offering that class here at Unity Church of the Hills. Coincidence? That class is starting on September 19th. It's a 3-week class with 2 weeks of practical, how are you going to use your gifts once you've discerned what they are? How about that? And then we're going to have a party on 11/7 where we get to celebrate all the things that you've done in that two-month period using your gifts. And here's one idea that I just thought was pretty profound.
Nathan's side and my side.
Tracy Jocelyn says this temporary shelter is a godsend.
We got a beautiful bed. Most of them have a raised up bed.
It's only 60 square feet of indoor living space.
It's just really warm and awesome and amazing.
The main thing, it gets Tracy off the streets and into a secure spot.
When you have a place to keep your possessions dry and safe instead of hauling them around, then you can start stabilizing your life and figuring out what the next step is.
They're known as Conestoga Huts. They got the name Conestoga Huts because they look similar to a Conestoga wagon, the precursor to the prairie schooners that helped settle the West.
I designed the Conestoga Hut.
Eric DeBurr of the group Community Supported Shelters is the driving force behind this effort, all from donations. He says Conestoga Huts are stronger and more permanent than tents. And at $2,500, much less expensive than tiny homes, which can cost anywhere from $10,000 to $20,000. And they take only a few hours to assemble, rather than weeks for tiny homes.
Oh, it's a great idea. It's very transitional.
David Qualley leads a group of volunteers from the Eugene community in putting in the finishing touches in their 84th Conestoga hut.
They're weatherproof. They're insulated, they're lockable, which is really important because a lot of people on the street lose their stuff.
I would say this place pretty much saved my life.
James Clapp lives at the Conestoga Hut Village, designed especially for veterans. There are several of these group sites around town, and they're empty during the day, with people living here out in the community getting mental health services and job counseling.
Where I'm going to go from here, I'm looking for new employment opportunities.
But Eugene is one of only two Northwest cities to embrace the idea of dealing with homelessness in this fashion.
They look nice and they look orderly. And so I think people in the community appreciate the look of it as well.
It was fantastic. It gave me a stable place to operate from.
And Jeff Howard says the program works. He's gone from a Conestoga hut to his own apartment and a future.
One person. Now, if someone here, a group here, as you're looking at your gifts and you feel called to do that, Graham and I have decided we will fund the first house out of our money. Yes. This is important stuff. I get emotional. I know I got tongue-tied a few times as I'm talking about this because it matters. It matters to me, and I'm passionate about it. And because I'm passionate about it, don't hear that that means everything else doesn't matter. This is my passion. What's your passion? You know, maybe your passion is to teach others how to center and to meditate. And that's good. We need all of it, my friends. We need all of it. So just hear that before you start writing me emails. Just hear that. Lastly, be patient with yourself and others when you start this process. Do baby steps. Find something really small to start with. And as you take those steps, you'll find that the steps get bigger. You'll start running. Doors are going to start opening. And it's a whole new way of being. So be patient with yourself. Be patient with others. Because guess what? We are going to do this very imperfectly once we start going. We're going to make a lot of mistakes. Because we know mistakes are the stepping stone to something greater, right? So I invite you to really jump into this fall faith that we're doing, looking at our spiritual gifts and pushing outward into really making this world a place that we get to say, yeah, I touched that. Yeah, I helped over there. And that's better because I was there with that. Let's prepare for meditation.
Let me bring love.
sing praise. Where there's despair, let me bring hope. Where there is blindness, let me bring light. Where there is
Let's take that nice deep breath in and exhale. Allow yourself to have your feet planted firmly on the ground. Allow Mother Earth to support you as we do this energy work together. Take another deep breath in. And exhale, releasing any fear, releasing the intellect, releasing the criticism, releasing the judgments, and be the truth of who you are. Divine human being, allow the spark of the divine to flood your system now. And as you feel that pulsing energy rocking through your body, it's safe. You are safe. This is who you always are. We just work so hard to cover it up, to push it aside, to fit in here. But this energy, the energy of God that flows in and as you, is your truth, is your power. Allow that energy to connect with every spark of the divine in here. Allow it. Feel that energy now get greater and greater. Feel that energy pulse out to this campus, blessing it, prospering it. Holding the divine as the root system in every tree, in every blade of grass on this campus. Feel that energy pulse out again into this community, the city of Austin. And as you pulse there, allow the divine to speak to you. Allow the divine to whisper in your ear the next step for you in your evolution of consciousness, as we take a moment in the silence. Allow that energy to fold back in to each individual person here. And feel the renewal of that energy flowing through and as you. James, Susan, Sally, Tammy, Kay. Feel that. That beauty is you. That beauty is us. That beauty is me. And so let's take that breath again. Inhale and exhale. Bringing your awareness, your consciousness, to the sanctuary, to my voice, to the seat supporting you. You may want to open your eyes. You may feel some pulsing going on underneath your skin. It's okay. You are safe. That's who you are. Your energy. Your energy, my loves. That's the norm. Feel that. Be with that. Namaste.
So in the service this morning, I was reminded of a story of my own journey where I felt like I was a few steps from being homeless. I had lost my job in early 2011, and I was driving back from the unemployment office, and this gentleman approached me right at the intersection of 2222 and 360, right at that bridge. And I could see him walking up with his little cup. And I looked at him, and I could just feel the anger boiling in me because I didn't have a contingency plan for this layoff. I didn't have savings. I didn't have a plan B. I was scraping and trying to figure it out. And so he approaches my car window, and before this poor, sweet man can say anything to me, I just roll down my window and yell at him and say, I just left the unemployment office. I don't even know how I'm going to buy groceries. I don't know how I'm going to make it. I have nothing to give you. And he looks at me with this beautiful smile. And in this beautiful Jamaican accent says, it's okay. It's okay. Jesus loved you. He really, really do. And the water, just the tears came down, and I said, I'm so sorry, I'm so sorry. He said, it's gonna be okay. And I think about that story every time I see someone in need, because we never know where life is going to take us. And as we think about where we can put feet to our prayers, a term my friend, dear friend, Joni Lorraine gave me years ago, it's right here in this community. It's in this offering that we are about to receive. It's in what is mine to do. And that can begin right here. Because these words on this affirmation card that Reverend Cherie read earlier and we said together aren't just words. It's up to us to help bring this into fruition. And so there are lots of ways that you can give to this community. You can set up your online recurring gifts. You can text to give, and you can give with our dear sweet ushers who are coming forward now. We will be passing the basket. So I invite you to say with me our prayer for affirmation, our blessing. Divine love through me blesses and multiplies all that I am, all that I have, all that I circulate, and I am grateful. Thank you.
So we just have a moment of thanksgiving for all the gifts, all the tithes that have been given to this week community. And we see them multiplying for the giver and for what we can do outside from these gifts. And so it is. Amen. Thank you, Tracy. Woo-hoo! Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. All right. So, you know, prayer chaplains are going to be in the chapel, so if you're feeling like you'd like to have some affirmative prayer, please go over there. It's beautiful. I did tell you I have my own, personal prayer chaplain, and she just loves me up, and it's just wonders, and I'm glad that I have that. So if you can take advantage of it, please do. Did you know? Kay, where are you? Kay, where are you? Did she leave? Kay, come on. Yes, my diva, come on, make that entrance. That's right, come on down. Can I say the number? 80, baby. 80 looks that good. 80 looks that good. Yeah, she's like, grumble, 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 grumble. Why is she calling me up? Today is our last day as our beloved musical director. So we just want to honor you. Thank you. Would you like to say anything?
Thank you. Thank you. It's been a journey, hasn't it? I think I've been here for all of you, because I started way back when it all first started. I'm not really good with goodbyes, so this isn't really a goodbye. Roderick's gonna lead you right on the same way we've been going, and I'll be dropping it every once in a while. I'll beg them if I can save them. Maybe they'll let me, I'm not sure. I love you all, and I've been so happy to serve, and I'm just looking forward to the next chapter, and I expect all of you to continue to make this congregation, this church, this beautiful place grow. I love you all. Thank you.
Just the card, nothing on it, just the card, that's all.
I just put your flowers in the book.
Wow, that's awesome. Okay. So I said this morning in prayer that I'm holding the knowing that Susan is going on these adventures, wonderful vacations. She's already dropped some hints that I'm super jealous about. So we're just knowing that you're going to have a fabulous next journey. Yeah, thank you. She's leaving a legacy here, my friends, a legacy. And so we just will honor that legacy, continue to see the expression of the musicians and the vocalists and what we do here together to just really feed your soul and inspire you to greatness. That's what we're here to do. All right, so what's happening next week? Next week, I'm here again. And we're going to talk about coming together. How do we come together as a community? And how, as a community, do we allow and support the growth that's happening? You know, we're all now taking off in new ways and awakening in different ways. And can we hold all of that at Unity Church of the Hills? And my answer is, of course we can. So come back next week. That's what we're going to be talking about. All right, are you ready to end the service with a prayer of protection? All right, let's do that. The light of God surrounds us. The love of God enfolds us. The power of God protects us. The presence of God watches over us. Wherever we are, God is, and all is well. Blessings. I'll see you next week.